Today on the Rock Newman Show, when Kenny Williams, the executive vice president of the Chicago White Sox, and Zoraida Sambolin, a nationally known news host, got engaged, their love was rich but private. But when Zoraida was diagnosed with breast cancer, they shared their love and struggles with the world. That's coming up next on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the historic campus of Howard University, the greatest institution of higher learning in the history of the world. It is my desire to inspire you with great stories of extraordinary achievement. Power couple Kenny Williams and Zoraida Sambolin are not ones to back down from a challenge. In 2000, Kenny became the first black general manager of the Chicago White Sox, and Zoraida talked her way into her first news position in 2002. So when Zoraida was diagnosed with breast cancer, they did what they always do. They powered through. Both of you, welcome. Thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to come see us here at Howard University on the Rock Newman Show. Just recently, you're here in town visiting and you were at an event where POTUS showed up. Can you tell us a little bit about that event?
It was a Congressional Hispanic Caucus Institute. It's their annual gala. They have a conference that they do every year, and then it culminates with a big gala on Thursday evening.
Thursday
it was
night.
Thursday night. And so I had a chance to emcee that. We have about 2,500 people in the crowd, so it was a sold-out crowd this year. Lots of celebrities and Congress members in the audience. But really the focus of that evening is to make sure that the programs are funded for all of the kids. So they help high school kids, college kids, and even kids that are in graduate school achieve high expectations and lots of opportunities for these kids.
You know, we've got a lot to talk about. Before I do, I've got some housekeeping that I must do here. And I'm going to ask the control room if they might be able to pull up a photo. It's something that was taken just recently at the Nats game. That happens to be my beautiful bride on that screen, Dee Dee, and it's our 31st wedding anniversary.
Bravo.
Looking at that picture and then looking at the two of you, Kenny Williams, there's something you and I both have in common. We seriously married over our heads. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. And all my friends and family remind me of that constantly.
I
agree with them.
I did hear at your wedding in July that Jerry Reinsdorf took time to once again remind you that you married way over your head.
Oh, he loves Zoraida. I mean, I've seen him emotional just a few times in the 30 some odd years that I've known him, and I've seen him only hug a select few people. Every time he sees her, he puts his arms around her. So I kind of knew I was on the right track then.
He's a loving good man, so I adore the man.
A loving good man.
Yes.
Tell us, our Washington DC viewing audience, what made you fall in love with that man?
Wow, so many things. But when I first met Kenny, he had this this air about him, I guess. And he was in total control of every situation. And so when I met him, it was the first thing that attracted me to him, was just his disposition. As I got to know him, it was his character that made me fall in love with him. But I like a strong man that is very confident, and he exudes that, in spades. So that was an easy attraction. But when you get to know somebody and you understand the content of their character, that is, to me, that was a tipping point. It was like, okay, this is, a serious contender in my life, because the man that he is a man that I've always thought, I wanted in my life. Not just for me, but I have two kids that I'm raising, and I wanted to make sure that they had that in their lives as well.
You think I'm gonna let you off the hook?
Well, it's easy for me. I mean, it was when we met, I was not looking for a relationship. And when we met, we've talked about this before, it was literally as though my feet were stuck in cement. cement. And I was so captivated by her. And we were both in situations at the time that, we were not interested. And was just, it was one of those love at first sight and actually first conversation things for me. Yeah. And I thought, I better run fast. I better run real fast, and I didn't run fast enough, evidently.
I was like, which,
and that's, a good thing for me.
Instead of running in the opposite direction, you came quickly in her way.
That's a good thing for me. She's inspired me in so many ways. I'm probably the best man that I've ever been because she's come into my life, and that's in a lot of different ways.
I read something, a quote of yours, that said that you were the happiest you'd ever been in your life.
Yeah. Yeah, and people around us constantly, no one ever says that Zoraida's much better off now and she's so happy now, and it's easy to say, but people are always coming up to her and saying, he is so much happier and he's so much nicer, and mm-hmm. Yeah, I own it. I gotta own it.
Sort of as in, this love has brought out the best in you.
Yeah, it has. It has. And so, like I said, in so many different ways, I can't even name them all. But, that's what it's supposed to be, right? A little give and take and a little, one person complimenting the other through this thing we call life. And it's life is easier. I never realized how easy a relationship can be. I've watched you and Didi over the years, and I've been envious, and congratulations, to you and Didi. I've been envious, and I'm not so envious anymore because I have some of that.
Yeah. So you guys got engaged. We're doing this, and this pink around here, the production crew's just done a fabulous job.
Yeah.
We're doing this in Breast Cancer Awareness Month. So, if I know the story correctly, you guys got engaged somewhere around New Year's Eve, Christmas holiday, and a few months later, Zoraida, you were diagnosed with cancer.
Yes, we were engaged in December, and shortly after that, it was in April that I got diagnosed with breast cancer. So it was really, in some respects, kind of like a shock, and in some respects not a shock, because I've had a history of problems with fibrocystic breast disease, dense breast tissue. So I was constantly, even though I was in New York because I was working for CNN, I was still going back to Chicago and getting my mammograms and ultrasounds, and every 6 months they were calling me in to do that. I even had a breast cancer when I first met Kenny, which was so bizarre. I went in for my annual mammogram, and they did an ultrasound, and they said, we found a mass, and we think it's cancer. And I went into the OR having just met Kenny. And when I told him about it, his response was, well, we're going to get through this together, and this is going to be okay. And I don't know, how long were we together? I mean, it was just... We were having
maybe
more of phone conversations than anything else. Yeah. And, he was there. He was there when I came out of the OR. Thankfully, at that point, it was not cancer. But I knew how he was going to react. I knew what I had in my corner when I got diagnosed. He was the first phone call that I made when I was diagnosed. And within, 30 seconds, he had a plan of attack. Because that is who Kenny is. We're going to get through this. It's going to be fine. We're going to get through this together. What's next? How are we going to tackle this? Vintage Kenny. Not for a second did he waver in his support.
When you first got the news, did you have to figure out how to tell him? How did you feel when you got it, knowing you guys had just started your relationship? Was that much of a challenge for you?
No, at that point, when I had the first cancer scare, it was one of those, I just very matter-of-factly told him, this is what's going on. And his reaction was just, it was unbelievable. When I got the diagnosis that I really did have cancer, I guess the first thing that I thought about were my kids. That's the first thought that came to my mind. And then I had a full conversation with the woman on the phone, and then I hung up the phone and I didn't even think about it. I just called Kenny because I thought, this is who needs to have this information too. This is who needs to know. So it was kind of like an extension of myself. My worry was for my kids. Yeah. But my worry was not about, how is Kenny going to react to this? On the contrary, I just thought, okay, here's my partner. I need to call him. And he was in Chicago. I was in New York at the time. Yeah. And I just needed to make that connection.
Yeah. Interestingly enough, though, I had trouble accepting it initially.
Yeah.
and didn't believe it. Well, okay, this isn't happening. This is like the last time. This is a scare that is in. And you know, we men as partners, you know, people I think forget that it's not just the one when you're in a relationship, whether it's the male or female, it's not just that person who's gotten cancer, who's gotten the diagnosis. You both get it.
Yeah.
So I was in denial until, and then it kind of slowly, I was in denial for quite a while,
yes,
actually. Yeah. So I don't believe.
Denial as in disbelief?
Disbelief. Disbelief, this isn't happening. This isn't happening. Mm-hmm. But, you know, obviously as time went on, you know, it's something that you have to accept, you've got to confront, and you've got to attack.
When you first got that news, you're fresh in a relationship. What was your, so you were, you first went into denial. Once you accepted that it was real, how did Kenny Williams feel then, and what did Kenny Williams do?
Well, you go through, like I said, when you're in love with someone and you are there, it is, you get it as well. So it is a surreal feeling, but one in which, okay, you've made this commitment to love someone and to care for them, and that truly is, if you are any sort of a man, that truly is in sickness, you know, and any of the other things, any of the other obstacles that come your way. So you're either going to step up, you know, people say you're either going to step up or step out, but I don't think there's the step out alternative. There's the step up, and that means different things for different people. But one of the tragic things that we have discovered in our journey is that there are not enough men stepping up to the plate and supporting their women. So I was going to make sure that she knew every step of the way that she was going to be supported and supported, you know, from beginning to end and in no uncertain terms.
And Kenny, both of you, we really want to get into that journey so that our viewers can have a snapshot of what it's like. You've been an athlete all your life. You've played team sports at the very highest level. You came through as a player, got into management, scouting management, and then became a general manager, and you guys won the World Series. So you've been involved in team sports all of your life.
Yes.
What, if anything, did those experiences, how did it help you to deal with this situation?
You know, that's an interesting question, and one in which I've never been asked from that vantage point. I don't know that sports taught me any lessons to prepare for this thing we call life and some of the challenges. I tell you what did prepare me. I have a father and a stepmother, and they are as happy of a couple as you can be, and that was an example for me. And my father went through a prostate cancer surgery, in which, and I've got to say before, you know, we're talking about breast cancer,
yes,
but too many of our men, and particularly black men, are dying because they won't go get tested for prostate cancer.
Yeah.
The screening is not a comfortable feeling, as we all know, but it's a necessary thing because we're losing too many men to the disease. Now, the point I wanted to make is my mother actually talked my father into going to see the doctor and getting this exam, and the doctor said if he waited one more month, he would have been gone. He would not be here today.
Wow.
And they were able to go in and get the cancer out. So I was kind of prepared. I saw a strong woman standing by her man years ago, and so I knew what that looked like.
Yeah.
So this is, you know, for me, it was my opportunity more than anything, you know, to show her how much I loved her. It's easy sometimes to tell someone, I love you, I'm there for you.
Yeah.
But when the you-know-what hits the fan, are you going to be there or not?
Yeah. Zoraida, so you tell this strong guy, you have two children you have to share the news with.
It was, I'd say, you know, when I first got the diagnosis of cancer, the first thing you think about, I think most women think about, is death. right? You know, what does this mean? Does this mean that I'm going to die? And so that's why my kids were front and center, because my daughter at the time was only 9 years old. And I'm thinking, okay, I've got to figure this out, because I have two kids that rely on me. And not only do they rely on me, the other thing I remember thinking about that night, because that night is when I broke down, I didn't have Kenny with me. And, you know, I didn't have enough information, and I had just gotten off the phone with the doctor, and I had not jumped into research, so I had a little pity party. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was when I started thinking worst case scenario, that movie plays out in your mind of, you know, what is it that would be the loss? And to me, the big loss was not being able to see my children grow up, not being able to go to their weddings, not being able to be a grandmother. That's when I hit rock bottom that night. And I said to myself, after that night, this is it. From this point forward, it's going to be about action and being proactive about my health and what's going to happen next. Try to learn as much as I possibly can. And Kenny and I did that together. I mean, he came to New York, and as you know, I was doing all of my research, and I have to say CNN helped a lot too, because there's a woman there in the medical unit who I called also, and so we did develop a plan of attack. How are we going to do this? What are my options? And let me look at this as if this is not Zoraida, but it's somebody else. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it's kind of like being a journalist and, you know, digging for information. And so that helped me tremendously. But Kenny went with me to all of my doctor visits, you know, as we were trying to figure out, well, exactly what is this, and then how do you tackle it. And you know what I found along the way, Rock, which is why anytime anybody gives me an opportunity to talk about this, and I really am grateful to you, I take it, because you know this is such an inexact science.
Yeah.
And you have, as a woman, you know, you don't have a medical background, and yet mm-hmm. there's so much medical information that you have to absorb, and then you have to decipher, like, what is the best treatment for you? Right. Sometimes it's just a gut thing. Mm-hmm. I think this is the way I should go because of everything that I'm seeing, all of the information that I'm getting. And as women, we need to respect and support each other that way. If you choose to have a mastectomy mm-hmm. and I choose to not have a mastectomy and I choose a lumpectomy and radiation, good for you and good for me. Mm-hmm. Because there is so much information out there, and you have to make the best decision that is right for you.
You were moved and inspired by Angelina Jolie.
Oh, God, I was.
And you, how did that come about?
It was so bizarre. I'm headed into...
She was inspired to make the announcement that yeah. she had, because yeah. I was watching that morning, and we had been talking, well, how is she going to, you know, make this announcement and tell people, because she's going to be off the air for a while.
Yeah.
So I found out with the rest of America when she decided to make this announcement.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay.
No, it was really, I agonized over this, Rock, because how
independent woman you?
But how do you tell your viewers that you have breast cancer? How does it just come up in regular conversation with your co-anchor?
Yeah.
So poor John Berman, who was my co-anchor at the time, you know, I just kind of dumped this on him that morning. And the reason is, as I was driving into work, my producer sent me an article on the op-ed piece that Angelina Jolie had in the New York Times. And what she did was talk about the double mastectomy that she had because of she was BRCA2 positive. Mm-hmm. And so she chose proactively to have her breasts removed and to have reconstruction. And it was a beautiful piece. We were leading with it on the news. Mm-hmm. And so my producer wanted to prepare me that this was going to be a dialogue that we were going to be having all morning. And then our big boss at the time, Jeff Zucker, said, you know, tell her to handle it however she sees fit. And I still wasn't convinced that I would talk about my personal experience, but there were people already criticizing Angelina Jolie and saying that she was glamorizing the idea of a double mastectomy. Mm. And that's when this thing kicked in of, mm. you know, I need to protect, because I know that this is not glamorous. This is not an easy decision for her.
Yeah.
And how dare you yeah. judge someone when you are not walking in their footsteps. And so to me, that was a moment that I said, I know, at least I know this much. I know that this is not something that is glamorized, and I know it was not an easy decision for her. And that opened up the opportunity to talk about what was going on.
So you went public, and Kenny found out yeah. that you were going public
when
you went public.
Yeah.
Now, had you told the kids prior?
I did. The children already knew. They didn't find out right away. We took our time trying to figure out what is the best way to tell your children. I consulted a psychologist, especially for my daughter. I was very concerned about her because she sees me and she sees herself. Yeah. I have had C-sections, and she refers to my scar and asks me if she's going to have a C-section in the future. Yeah. And so I know that when she sees me, she sees herself, and I was worried about what questions were coming my way.
How old were your kids?
My daughter was 9 years old, and Nico was 15 years old at the time, 14 years old at the time. Because he's about to be 16. So my son, it was a little bit easier. We're very, very, very close. He was my only child for 5 years. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of know the way that he thinks. So I bought a book called Breast Cancer for Dummies, which is a fabulous book. Mm-hmm. And in it, it talks about all the different types of breast cancer. And so I pinpointed my type of breast cancer, and I sat with him, and he knew that something was going on, but he didn't know what specifically. Mm-hmm. So I sat in his bedroom with him, and I asked him what he thought about when he heard the words breast cancer. And he said to me, I think about a fight. And I thought, great, because we are in a fight right now. I have breast cancer, and we're going to fight this together. And then I sat and I explained everything in the book and exactly what was going on. He wanted to know if I was going to die. I told him I was not going to die. And then he disappeared for a while to kind of digest all of the information. And the way, you know, he's a boy, you know, the way that he processed everything was he started texting all of his friends, found out that one of his girlfriend's mother had breast cancer. They were able to discuss it all. And so he found healing that way. With my daughter, I sat down with her and I asked her what she thinks about breast cancer, or when she hears the words breast cancer, and she said, oh, I think about hair falling out and people getting really sick. And I said, well, my hair's not gonna fall out and I'm not gonna get really sick, but I have breast cancer. Her next question to me was, why did you ask for my picture last week? That was it. That was the end of the discussion with my 9-year-old. That was sufficient for her to hear that my hair was not going to fall out and that I wasn't going to get sick. I will say that in the year, that we have gone through everything, there are a lot of questions that she has had. I have been, you know, very open with her. I unrobe in front of her. We talk about everything. Right. And she's had questions as to whether or not specifically this is going to happen to her. Mm-hmm. And my answer is, I don't know. I just don't know. But what I do know is that if it does, we will figure it out.
Okay, you said something, because so many people, the image of breast cancer, cancer period, is bald heads, hair falling out. You told her yours, that wasn't going to happen.
How did I know?
How did you know that?
I had already made a decision, pretty much a decision, that I was going to have a double mastectomy. And I had a diagnosed cancer in one breast. And in the other one, it was inconclusive. They weren't sure what was going on. But my gut told me that, you know, probably if it wasn't immediate, that in the future I was going to be facing a cancer in the other breast. And so I knew that if I did the double mastectomy, at least I thought at that stage of the game, because it was such an early stage of breast cancer, that I would not have to go through chemotherapy. And so that's how I knew that I was not going to be facing hair loss.
Well, there's a little more to it. And I think this is why it's important that the spouse, the boyfriend, accompanies the person who has been diagnosed with this to all the doctor's appointments, because when that person is going through it, there's some things, there's some questions that need to be asked, and some comments from the doctor that need to be remembered. One of the things that we were told is that she had, out of all of the mammograms at this particular hospital, she was in the top three that had the most difficult mammograms to read because of the density of her breast tissue. Mm-hmm. So that alone, even with a regular, if someone says, well, you can get a lumpectomy and, you know, get it out of there, well, with the density that we're talking about with her, it would have been very easy to miss. And that was one of the things that largely kind of went into the decision, is because they couldn't really definitively tell where it was and what it was. And she was right.
End
of the day, she was right. And the other one, when they took, you know, they examined the other one after the double mastectomy, she also had it in there.
Yeah, it was just, it was one of those things. That's why I say sometimes your gut, you just know better. Yeah. But I had a team of radiologists that were amazing. And really, at the beginning of this journey, those are the people that you really sit with, that really give you the most information. Mm-hmm. Before you make the decision as to what your course of treatment is, these radiologists have so much information and so much knowledge. And I had a great deal of respect and trust in my radiologist. I had him for years. And when he said to me, look, Zoraida, I don't think it's an if, but it's a when in your case. Mm-hmm. And so you need to make the decision that is right for you. Mm-hmm. Because I think that there will be a cancer in that breast, maybe not right now, but in the future. And it was because it was so dense that he thought, we're going to miss something. We're going to miss something. And so he really empowered me a great deal to make this decision.
Kenny, again, as an athlete, as a baseball executive, you're known for your just bulldogged intensity and commitment and 24 hours, 7 days.
When I met her, I dialed it back.
Yeah, okay, so you had already dialed it back a little bit. How did this crisis, what did it do for you and your life priorities?
You know, the interesting thing is once word got out, one of the shocking things that happened to us was so many of our friends that we had no idea had breast cancer, mm-hmm. and had some of them had mastectomies, mm-hmm. had come to us and, you know, I've had it too. We've experienced it as well. And no one ever said anything. So, and I think that is, and we've talked about it, I think that's a mistake.
Yeah.
Because the more people talk about some of these things, particularly if they hit one segment of the community harder than another, then you can save lives. You can save the matriarch of your family, yeah. If you address it and you address it, you know, head on early. And that's the key, and that's the message. That's why we talk about it. And you know, neither one of us is really comfortable outside of, you know, her job and my job of being very public people. But we feel that it's our duty. We've been blessed and we've been fortunate to have the prognosis that we have now. And if we don't use our experience to educate other people, then I think we've missed the boat.
You know, I find that absolutely fascinating. If you juxtapose that effort of yours to get the word out and to talk about cancer, breast cancer, prostate cancer, whatever it is, because especially in the African American community, there are families historically that won't even say the word.
Yeah, yeah. And it's a shame. But, you know, but one of the things that we came up with was, and she hosted the Susan G. Coleman Gala last year here in Washington, D.C. And as we were walking out, I came up with an idea to try to pink out our stadium. And so this year we had a day, and she threw out the first pitch. and we had a day where we tried to pink it out as much as we can. It was very well received, and word spread. So we feel like, you know, we're trying to, you know, this is one of our callings, is to try to make an impact. But it's not just about the disease, and I keep talking about it. And I guess so, when you ask about the sports angle of it, I guess that's one thing that I didn't really focus on until then. If it weren't for the sports and my position in sports, then, you know, we may not have gone, we wouldn't have been able to do the pink out, and then who knows who was affected by that day.
We did so many free mammograms. You know, women received vouchers that day to have free mammograms if they didn't have health insurance. But I think the biggest issue, and you just talked about it, is fear. Last year I was also the spokesperson for Susan G. Komen in the Hispanic community, and I could not believe the women who would not go get a mammogram because they are scared of what they're going to be told.
With a history in their family.
Oh, my gosh. And I think, why would, you know, here's the deal. We, historically, whether you're African American or you are Hispanic, mm-hmm. family is the most important thing to you. Yeah. And so if you don't take care of yourself, then you cannot be there for your family. And the fear could actually kill you. And so if there's just one message that I could give women that, you know, yes, it's scary. It is the scariest diagnosis I have ever gotten in my life. But I was lucky that it was early enough that I was able to control part of it. And that's really important, to be able to say, okay, I can make some decisions here about my health going forward. And then I can give my kids the best chance to have their mother around, and my husband to have his wife, and my mom and dad to have their daughter, and my sisters to have me. You know, it really empowers you to know that then you have options. I call breast cancer one of the greatest blessings that's ever happened to me. I don't know that I would feel that way if, you know, I would have been on death's door. But I do know this, that it changed my life. It allowed me to prioritize and to understand what was the most important thing in life. Tomorrow is not promised. And so, you know, I made a decision to leave CNN and go back to Chicago because I knew that I cannot control my destiny. I cannot control how long I'm going to be on this earth. So for the time that I am on this earth, I am going to make sure that my priorities are set. And my priorities are my husband, my children, my family. And work, I love. But, you know, I say I never once thought, the thought of, oh, what's going to happen to my job did not cross my mind until I had to decide how I was going to tell my viewers.
Yeah. You were at our wedding. Everyone in the room, the way that we came up with the guest list, and there are some people that are not happy with us, but everyone that was in that room, the main criteria, the one criteria was they had to reach out and ask how she was when she was going through this. Yeah. So everyone in that room showed love, showed care, and you were one. You and Dee Dee were two. Yeah.
And an extraordinarily happy, beautiful, wonderful wedding it was. So I know we've said this a thousand times, but thank you so much for inviting us.
We were honored to have you there.
You got all of your information collectively. You made a decision as to what route you were going to take. I think that took courage. Were you fearful?
Yes, I was. And I'll tell you, I was embarrassed because one of the things that really bothered me was my femininity. And for the life of me, I had a very difficult time reconciling losing my breasts and the sexuality of that and the cancer. And I'm thinking, I am a rational woman. I am a smart woman.
Yeah.
These breasts have to go. Why would I care? And the fact that I cared embarrassed me. And so that was part of the struggle that I was going through is, you know, I didn't necessarily want to lose my breast, but I knew that it was the best decision going forward. And I reconciled the whole thing about femininity and sexuality, but I wanted to talk about it because I thought there have to be other women also who are feeling that as well.
Mm-hmm.
It is a part of who you are. And I did get reconstruction. I decided mm-hmm. for the double mastectomy, and then I went through reconstruction. But there are all sorts of things that happen with that. I mean, you lose all of your sensation in your breasts, and so it is kind of a change. But totally worth it because you get life on the other end. But it was a moment of truth, and it was a complicated thing to have to deal with.
I don't know if I've ever really heard anybody talk about it in terms of sexuality. It's just kind of like, don't take that step. I've never heard it privately, and I've never heard it publicly.
Well, she also worried about how I would feel.
And I wanted to ask you, she just expressed how she felt. How did you feel in that regard?
She cared more about that area than I did.
Uh-huh.
Because I looked at, I'm a sometimes very black and white person with regards to decisions that have to and need to be made. So my soon-to-be wife had breast cancer. Those things were the cause of it. They have to go.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever she looks like after, whatever we have to deal with in the aftermath is inconsequential to the fact that this is the remedy. This will allow her to be here tomorrow and the next year and live our lives together. So that was now what I did. So from my perspective, I'm like, this is not a problem. Do not worry about how I am going to react to this. What I did worry about is, again, how her, what sexually knowing her and how she felt about herself, how she felt about her looks, how she felt about not having any feeling, that worried me more than anything. So you know, we still have conversations about it. And I think because we've had an open dialogue about it, that it's made things easier and better for both of us. We just had a conversation yesterday about, okay, well, do you have any worries about this metastasizing in another area, another way? And I had to tell her, I said, you know, I have worried about that myself, you know, and we think that the chances are very slim, given the action that she took, but those are our primary concerns. You know, this intimacy rock comes in very different, shapes and many different forms. It is, and we often talk about just the pure sexuality of our intimacy.
Sure.
But the reason why I wanted to change her drains, for instance, and I wanted to be the one to do that, is because that kind of intimacy is really an expression of love beyond the sexuality part of it, right? And that is saying, here's where we are. We've gone through it together. Life has brought us to this point, but I'm going to take care of you, just as she would take care of me if the situation were reversed. So there is no greater intimacy, in my opinion, than such a thing. Now, my girlfriends who have gone through mastectomies and her friends, they advised us against that at all.
Against you getting involved in the whole process of draining the fluids and that sort of thing.
She did not want to do it.
And you were stubborn and insisted.
You became comfortable with it.
Oh, I did, totally. I mean, part of the reason I didn't want him to do it is that he does not like blood. He doesn't like to see blood. And I knew that part of the bodily fluids, because essentially what they do when they take out all of your tissue is then they put these drains in, and all of your draining for, I don't even know how long we had to do those drains, way longer than I wanted to.
Weeks.
But yeah, it was weeks. But you have to actually measure the output, and in it there's blood. And I knew that that wasn't something that he was comfortable with. And then I had heard what one of his girlfriends in particular had said, you know, it's just not a pleasant experience. And you really don't want to see that. That is something you don't need to see.
Yeah.
And so, you know, but he insisted that it was something he wanted to do. And he even, he went out and he got a doctor's robe, stethoscope.
Okay.
He dressed up my son as an orderly.
Uh-huh.
And they would come down and, you know, have the form in one hand and everything that he needed on a tray to do this, and it would be like he was my physician and this was his assistant.
Yeah.
And so it became really like fun and funny, and it made me laugh, which is something you definitely need to do through this process. And it was fantastic. And he was the one calling my surgeon and saying, okay, so this is the fluid output this time, or I'm seeing these changes, what do you think? He would take pictures of, you know, changes that were going on to talk to the doctor about whether it was normal or not.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was just a level of involvement that was outstanding. And I do believe that this crisis brought us much closer together.
You know, I once sat at a wedding between a psychologist and a psychiatrist. I mean, literally, one was on one side and one was on the other side. And they were discussing, you know, such interesting stuff happens at weddings. They were discussing intimacy. And I remember one of them saying that true intimacy came when one felt safe enough to be totally vulnerable.
Yep.
Is that what you feel you
experienced? Absolutely.
Yeah?
Absolutely. You know, when, and Kenny knows, I use that safe word a lot. What I need to feel with him all the time is safe. That I know when I go into those arms, or when I'm standing next to him, or just, you know, whenever anything happens in life, that when I close my eyes and I think of him, I think of safe. And that is what I am with him. That, you know, there is nothing that is going to affect me while he has me. You know, he is going to make sure that everything is going to be okay as much as he can. And through this process, he showed me what it is, you know, I think he showed many people what it is to be a man and a loving husband. And he wasn't even my husband at the time yet. But he stepped up in ways that, you know, I knew what I had, you know, Rock, I knew. I knew that I had made a good choice in this man, but to go through that experience with him, I thought, I have hit the jackpot. I don't deserve this, but I am so grateful for it, for what I have.
But let's get real for a second on something that really bothered me through this whole process. In most of the waiting rooms I sat in, I was the only man in those waiting rooms, waiting for her to come out. The stories that she would come back and tell me about how some of the men, you know, she ended up putting together a panel on CNN and they discussed it very openly. But some of the stories where the men are telling the women, their spouses, you cannot go get tested for a mammogram. If something
they didn't
happens,
want them to have a mastectomy.
A mastectomy.
Like,
if something happens,
that.
If that happens, I'm leaving.
Oh my God.
Some did leave.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Real life cases.
Real life cases where my heart goes out to some of these women, and that's why we've got to have the dialogue more, because it should not be. She mentioned it the other night, and this woman celebrates me, and it makes me uncomfortable sometimes to all ends, but she mentioned it at the conference she hosted the other day, and there was applause when it was said, when she said, my husband stood by me.
Yeah.
Well, that should be a given. Mm-hmm. That should be a given. That's mm-hmm. that's like the young man that comes up to you saying, well, I've never been to jail. You're not supposed to go to jail,
right.
So we're not going to celebrate you for doing something that you were supposed to be doing right. So your spouse, your partner, your husband is supposed to do these things, and when you don't, you are less of a man. That is it's plain and simple to me. So out of all of this, yes, we have a good story, but I feel for the women that do not have the support of their mate. It's wrong.
And you are trying to have an impact in that area.
We are trying to talk about it whenever someone gives us a microphone.
You give me a microphone, and yeah, we're going to talk about it.
We've talked about your diagnosis. You made the choices. Tell us the experience of going and getting the surgery.
Oof.
I guess, you know, if I were going to be completely honest, it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. You know, I've had two kids, I've had two C-sections, and so, you know, that was a breath of my experience with surgery. I think everything went well. I woke up feeling better than I thought I was going to feel. You know, the whole thing of losing your breasts and getting reconstructed and all of that, I think that's a bit of a mind game, at least for me it was. But you know, I had unbelievable support, and so it wasn't as complicated as I thought it was going to be. We had some complications along the way, but we dealt with them. And the biggest challenge was, and I don't talk about this, Rock, typically, but when I was reconstructed, I was reconstructed larger than I wanted to be. I mean, you're asleep, so it's another person who kind of controls that decision.
Yeah.
And, you know, I guess,
we had input along
no,
the way.
No, I did, but exactly.
It turned out a little bigger than...
a little. Yeah. It was a lot bigger than I expected. And so, you know, I woke up and, you know, then you've got to go through life getting used to this different person that you are, this different reality.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to say, I had a really hard time with it. Every time I looked at myself in the mirror, I did not feel like Zoraida. And, you know, it was from the very beginning that I felt this way. And so the doctor would say to me, just take some time, and then see, you know, how you're feeling about this. I took almost a whole year living with this, and I just couldn't. So I went back and I said, look, I can't live like this. You need to go back in and give me something smaller so that I could feel more comfortable with what I am seeing when I look in the mirror, so I could feel more like me.
Mm-hmm.
And it was an instant change.
He did a great job.
So you got smaller.
I did. And he did a great job. Absolutely. I mean, everybody who saw me was like, oh my gosh, you look amazing. Yes, but I don't feel amazing.
Yeah.
And I was very blessed to have a plastic surgeon who really cared about how I felt.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was, okay, well, let's go in and let's make this right. And that's what we ended up doing. So that was the whole process of it. You know, it is something that I am aware of pretty much all the time, because it is an odd feeling. I'm thinking that at some point in life, maybe 10 years down the road, I'll get used to feeling this different kind of sensation.
Uh-huh.
but it is something that you think about often. And one of the things we were talking about was, you know, I am cancer-free right now, and I'm great. I'm taking tamoxifen. I'm scheduled to take it for 5 years. But one of the questions that I asked my oncologist early on as I was deciding whether or not I wanted to take the tamoxifen was, you know, what are the chances that the cancer will metastasize? Because it was an invasive cancer in my left breast. Even mm-hmm. though we caught it early, mm-hmm. it still broke through. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he said, I asked him, have you ever seen a case like mine that has turned into a metastatic breast cancer? Mm-hmm. And he said, yes, I have. Mm-hmm. And so that sobered me up. Like, mm-hmm. I need to take these drugs, I need to take care of myself, I need to be healthy, I need to eat right, I need to exercise, because I need to give myself the greatest chance to survive this long term, to get to that 5-year mark, that 7-year mark, where you know that you really have kind of, you know, gotten away with something.
Mm-hmm. And so let's talk about your recovery. What you just said, exercise, eat better, take the medicines. Talk to us about that.
Well, there's a drug right now, and I don't remember the drug, but there was a woman who has a metastatic breast cancer who is taking this new drug that has extended her life by 18 months. And one of the things that she said, which I firmly believe in, she said, look, I would have never been healthy enough to be able to survive all of the chemotherapy and the radiation and the drugs, everything that I've had to take, if I did not eat organically, exercise. In spite of what you're going through, your body has to be in the best possible shape in order to fight. And it's about eating right, it's about exercising, and it's about resting. You know, one of the things that I don't do very much of is shut it down. Mm-hmm. And those are new words for me, shut it down. My plastic surgeon, when he met me, he said to me, you are a type A personality. So the one thing I'm going to ask you to do is shut it down. Stop giving and receive. Because you don't think of, as women, are you kidding me? I'm taking care of Sophia, Nicolas, and Kenny. Yeah. And then I'll think about myself afterwards. Yeah. And so I think that in order for women to really be strong and be able to fight, they have to kind of reprioritize that too. You wake up in the morning, you have to think, you know, what can I do for myself today? Mm-hmm. How can I make sure that I have the best chance to fight? And that includes taking care of your body, exercise, eating right. Very important. And in our community, that's a little complicated sometimes.
Have you gotten comfortable with shutting it down?
At times, I'm much better, right, honey?
Yes, you are.
Yes,
you
I am much better than when he first met me. It's still a challenge for me, but, you know, I know that I need to rest. I know it sounds crazy and dumb, right? You know, but, you know, sometimes you just push a little too hard. But I do. I have these rules now. I'll only do so many events per month. And, you know, I know that I want to work a little bit harder, but maybe I should not be doing that particular thing. I shouldn't be pushing myself that hard. So I do. I'm conscious of that because I want to live. Yeah. It is my first priority is to be healthy.
You guys have become very informed. I know neither of you certainly claim to be a doctor. But you hear the word chemotherapy. And what people say is it's something that's put in your body and it has so much chance of killing the good stuff that's there. You know, it's just trying to eradicate the dead cells, the harmful cells, but it kills so many of the good. What's been your experience? What have you learned about chemo?
I have not had chemo, but so many women that I have interviewed and, you know, the sisterhood that I'm a part of now, so many have. And it's poison, Rock. I mean, when they say it's awful, it is awful. And this is why you have to make sure that you're getting the rest that you need and that you're, you know, replenishing your body, because there are long-term effects to chemotherapy. And it does, just like it destroys those bad cells, it also destroys good cells. And so you have to be in a position where you are taking very good care of yourself in order to be able to fight it. It's not, you know, I am so grateful I didn't have to have chemotherapy. It was my first, when I talked to the doctor, mm-hmm. the first thing I talked to him about was radiation and chemotherapy.
Yeah.
I have lived a pretty holistic life, and I don't like taking drugs. Yeah. And the idea of having to put drugs in my body and poison just, it really, it was very difficult to even have that discussion. I don't like the idea of taking tamoxifen, but I do it because I need to do it.
I sat down with a college roommate of mine last night who's been my friend ever since. His wife is going through chemotherapy right now. And it is a...
She's an aggressive form of breast cancer.
Yeah.
Triple negative.
And it is a debilitating thing to have to go through, but at the same time, the cancer is shrinking. Mm-hmm. So it may afford them the opportunity, once they go in for the lumpectomy, the opportunity to get it out and get it out before it becomes totally invasive. So, yeah. It's already invasive, you know, but the chances of survival, and that's what we're talking about here. No one likes it. Yeah. It kicks you dead in your butt. But you know, unfortunately, where we are medically right now, it's a necessary evil.
Again, you guys have just been all up in this. What, from a macro point of view, is it our diet?
Yeah. Those were the questions, see, and now you're going down a hole where those were the things. That's one of the things that, you know, when she's in her more vulnerable moments, it's been, I eat right, I exercise,
do everything right.
And why did I get this?
Yeah.
You know, so there are no answers.
No, I have no history of breast cancer in my family. I did get the BRCA testing, so it's not a genetic problem, at least not a gene that they've identified thus far. I have exercised, I've been a runner, and I eat right. I don't put junk in my body. And so when I got this diagnosis, I was baffled.
Yeah.
I thought, well, this doesn't happen to people like me, right? Yeah. Where did this come from? And yeah. It just all of a sudden showed up. So I don't know. I mean, you know, if they could figure that out, then we could figure this out. And so I think it's a combination of factors. And I think sometimes people are susceptible to things. Your biology, your chemistry, you're susceptible to something that the next person is not susceptible to. What's the trigger? Nobody knows, unless it's genetic.
So you guys have just done a fabulous job of walking, of taking this journey, of walking through this. So what's the future hold? What's the plans? You now are executive vice president of the Chicago White Sox. If I'm not mistaken, the highest ranking African American in Major League Baseball. You've been quoted as saying that if someone from the Oakland Raiders called you, they have you to run that team.
I'd be living in Oakland.
I'm a football guy, but it's that football background really helped me in the baseball world, because I probably look at more film of players than probably anyone out there. And some of my best decisions over the years have been because I will sit for hours upon hours, you know, looking at tape, and that came from football. John Elway was a college teammate of mine, and I recently had a conversation with him about going to the Bronco headquarters when they start talking about their scouting mm-hmm. techniques and everything, because I want to kind of delve into it. They do it better, I think, in the NFL in terms of being able to know their personalities and know their psychologically know what they're getting more than anybody else. Now, you know, they get it wrong sometimes too, as recent events you know have suggested, but I
can't have you on the show. Have you on this show. We're talking football right now and not talk about the game at Stanford.
Oh God, you talking about 1982?
You were on that team.
I was on that team, but I was not on the field mm-hmm. for that particular play mm-hmm. that you're talking about, with the band coming on the field.
Yes.
And we lost that game because the band came on the field and the guy ran through the band and scored a touchdown.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing was, the coach, Paul Wigan at the time, had me by my shoulder pads and said, Kenny, I want you to go in case someone breaks one and run them down. Mm. And it was the fastest guy on the team at the time, so that's why he said that. And then he said, no, come back, because so-and-so's a senior. I don't want to take him out on his last play of his college career.
Okay.
So I watched with the coach from the sidelines while all that madness happens. And I have to answer about two questions a year.
I had to bring that up.
And usually now you're one.
And I can't let you go without this one. You round third base in your Major League Baseball career, and you run over a third base coach.
Oh, that's, I can explain that.
And the tale says that you actually knocked him out as you rounded third base. Did you know this, Zoraida?
I didn't know.
No, I did not know.
I didn't know it knocked him out.
Multiple reports say KO.
He was in the way. It was a rundown play that went haywire. It was really a defensive. It was against the New York Yankees. I was playing for Toronto at the time, and I was stealing third base. Someone hit a pop up, so then I had to go back to second, and then they overthrew that. It went to the outfielder. The outfielder then, you know, as I'm going back, overthrows it again. But the third base coach had come close enough in the line, going to home, where he was in the way, so he had to go get out the way, and I scored.
And you scored.
And I scored. And
Zoraida, you're back on the camera. You're back on camera.
I did. I went back home to Chicago, and I went back home to the station that I left before I went over to CNN. So I'm with NBC5 in Chicago, still doing morning television, and loving serving, you know, that particular community that I know and love so well. I am a Chicagoan. I was born and bred. I lived for 4 years in Puerto Rico, but other than that, Chicago's home.
How are the kids doing?
They're great. Nicolas is about to be 16 years old, trying to get a driver's license. And he is a sophomore in high school, and he plays basketball and has a lot of ambition. So I fully expect to see him playing college ball, and then I expect to see him doing Kenny's job in basketball one day. And then Sophia, the love of our life, she is 11 years old, and she has an absolute heart of gold. We were talking about her on the way in, because Kenny always tells me, well, you know, when she hits those teenage years, she's going to be really difficult to handle, and, you know, I just don't see it. And, you know, at this
stage, I'm changing my she's the sweetest little girl in the world. You might avoid that.
Yeah, she's incredibly bright. She's a gifted artist, and you know, just has a heart of gold and a really good intellect. So Sophia will be whatever Sophia wants to be. But they're both doing incredibly well. They're very happy to be back home, too.
Has this experience, you think, made them better kids?
Oh, undoubtedly. Undoubtedly. You know, what I found was that I did not realize that I should have had high expectations of both of my children, particularly my boy, to be able to handle this. I mean, he just astounded me. I thought, wow, shame on me for not knowing that you were going to step up to the plate and you were going to do things that just I find remarkable. So I think, you know, for a kid that age, it really wisened him up and, you know, it made him grow up in a way that I think is really good and really healthy. And, you know, Sophia, she's always had this amazing heart. And, you know, she has this idea of us writing a book because of the experience that they have gone through. So we may let her bring that.
And I'll wrap this show by saying I think both of you guys have scored.
Aw, thank
you. And that wraps it up for us today, folks. Please, next time, I'll see you there.